here, of course, leader of the Green Party, MP for Saanich Gulf Islands. Thank you for being here.
Well, thank you. This book, having so much fun already.
Honestly, this book is a must read.
Thank you.
It isn't a must read for political people necessarily. It is a must read for people who want an amazing story of your life.
Thank you. I love writing, so if you love reading it, that makes me so happy.
Well, it's your eighth book, so it shows that you've definitely, you paint such a beautiful picture of from Connecticut to Cape Breton Island. And I really honestly want to start with that farm and how you were, well, actually, no, let's go back to the day you were born and how your mother was plugging the radio. So you were literally born to what?
I was born June 9th, 1954. And my mother, they had a, she described it to me that there was a radio in those days. There was like no TV in the room, obviously, 1954. She had to put nickels in a radio on her hospital bed to be able to stay tuned to listening to the Army-McCarthy hearings. And that was the end of Joseph R. McCarthy. People remember McCarthyism in the 50s and, you know, people blacklisted and committed suicide. His reign of terror ended that day when he was cross-questioned by Senator Segal, "Have you no sense of decency, sir?" That was the end of him. So that was, actually, I said in the book, this was the first sounds processed in my infant brain.
Political
newscasts, because my mom was plugging in the nickels.
And then you're, you know, a six-year-old child and already becoming...
Well, when I was a toddler even, my mother, once I was born, my mother read somewhere that nuclear weapons testing, which in those days was atmospheric testing, you know, so the fallout was going all around the world. It was really a pollution issue. It wasn't just a peace movement issue. It was pollution. My mother read somewhere that scientists were worried that the fallout was going to build up in children's bones and cause an increase in childhood leukemia. Right. So for that reason, suddenly my mother, who had no previous background in organizing, my dad was the one who was the breadwinner, very conventional life in the 50s. My mom was at home, and she just took up the cause of how do we stop atmospheric nuclear weapons testing.
And kept you home when the duck and covers were going on tests at school.
And I was going into kindergarten and telling the other children not to eat snow because it contained strontium 90. Like, how not to be popular in school.
In kindergarten.
In kindergarten.
Elizabeth May. Okay, and then your parents, farmers, Cape Breton Island, give you lambs.
Yeah, well, my parents were very eccentric, shall we say, and also they made split-second decisions. So we moved from Connecticut to Cape Breton Island. These little lambs were a present for Easter. They were pets. And we discover, and then when we had three of them die mysteriously, and it was when I was older, I read Silent Spring by Rachel Carson and discovered the symptoms that my sheep had died from matched perfectly with these pesticides. So then I wrote the town and found out they'd been sprayed. So when I grew up, I mean, I'd already accumulated all these files on pesticides. So when I was, you know, in Cape Breton Island, when they wanted to spray from airplanes over the forests, I was all organized. I had the files. I started, you know, and it was, I write in the book, no campaign is ever won by one person. No effort to protect a forest or stop a pesticide spray program happens because of one person. But sometimes you're in the right place in the right time.
You can be the agent of change.
To keep everything together. And when I've been very lucky over my life to often be in the right place at the right time to protect something important. And I've been lucky.
And you and your entire family have given it all from a very early and humble beginning. I honestly, so much to read and talk about. Like, that lamb made you and your brother become vegetarian, which is one thing I had to get out there, because when I read that, I'm like, this isn't somebody who went, I think I will, you know, take this on. You guys did from a very young age.
And when I was 10 years old and I was vegetarian, it was the only vegetarian I knew.
Right, because they were all coming on going, let us know when the lamb chops are going to be on the grill.
Yeah, and so one of my parents' friends said, and I talked about this in the book, when they said to my brother, well, if you're not eating them, what are they for? And he was about 8 years old. I said, oh, they're for to love. So we were always, I think those early experiences of being close to nature probably pushed me in the direction of being an environmentalist all my life. But the way my parents raised me, And it's so important is that we were taught when we were little that if you saw something in the world that you didn't think was right, you had to personally take responsibility to change that. So you can imagine what it was like for me in grade, you know, from being a little teeny kid with my mother trying to stop nuclear weapons testing, to seeing President Kennedy sign a treaty to stop nuclear weapons testing. And as far as I was concerned, my mommy did that.
Right.
So talk about feeling that sense of civic engagement early and knowing that one person can make all the difference. Obviously, there were thousands of moms like my mom working to get rid of nuclear weapons
testing. But it takes one to start.
It does.
Somewhere. Start. Act locally. And you know what? 5 minutes just went by so fast, I can't even believe it.
I just want everyone listening to know and watching. We have been taking a myth and swallowing it whole. And that myth is a lie that citizens in this country don't have power. Every single one of us does. Every single one of us. So we really need to shake off any notion that we're powerless or that we can be complacent. If you see something going on, take action. At a minimum, get out and vote for in the Vancouver municipal elections. I love the fact that the early polling is showing higher levels of voter turnout.
Yes.
When we have higher levels of voter turnout, we get the change we want.
Anything is possible, including the Green Party having their MP, their representative.
Well, my next plan is balance of power after the next election, so we could actually be able to say to other parties, we want to work with you. Because my whole approach is, let's be less partisan, more cooperative, and make change happen.
And the number one thing wrong with our country right now, I know I'm going over, I'm sorry. Number one thing wrong with our country right now.
I think it's that too many people feel they can't make a difference, so they're letting other people make the decisions for them. And it's our future on the line here, especially on the climate crisis, fighting pipelines and oil tankers on our coastlines. It's something where every single British Columbian can make a difference.
Be engaged. Be informed. Thank you, Elizabeth May. Honestly, this book reads, well, like a novel that is fact. It was a pleasure to read your book and a pleasure to have you
on
Breakfast Television.
Tell you what joy it was to meet you. Thank you, Jody.
Thank you. All right.
See you again.
Absolutely. Come anytime.